We've talked a lot today about being brave and having courage. You shush people. We've talked a lot today about being brave and having the courage to either take a small act or a big act, or whatever that may be. We've talked a lot about that, our speakers this morning, all in their own right. I found very courageous in the information that they shared with us. And I think Tomo Krishna, our speaker this afternoon, is a living example of that. And Tomo's a Slovenian writer, a journalist, documentary filmmaker, and human rights activist that has been lobbying for peace in Sudan since 1998. He's created a number of documentaries highlighting and drawing attention to the hidden genocide of indigenous peoples in Sudan, and I've had a chance to watch a couple of his films that are posted on YouTube, and it really puts into perspective some of the issues that are happening in the world that we can sometimes turn a blind eye to. And it takes brave people like him to go and share these stories. So in 2022, him and his wife, who I think his wife is here, right? Yeah. They created worked on a documentary called Rotting 2022, where they highlighted the lack of medical attention for those suffering from leprosy in Sudan. Everyone that I've asked about Tomo, and every time he's been introduced to me, they say he's one of a kind. They say there's no one in the world like him. Someone who's journeyed through the most dangerous parts of the world to document these atrocities and share their stories. So we're really very grateful to have him here today with us to share not just his story, but some of the stories of what he's seen. So please join me in welcoming Tomo Krishna.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I came directly from Nuba Mountains, South Kordofan, Sudan. I get information that I might be able to speak to you, to talk to you, about a year and a half, and I have to admit that I was preparing this speech for 1 year and a half in my head while walking through the mountains in Sudan or paddling canoe on the river of Nile and sleeping on sleeping nights. I was trying to focus on what can I say in 20 minutes that I experienced all my life and that I believe everybody should know. But let's first we hear themselves. The one that I want to introduce you now is a medical assistant, a very humble person. He's not a doctor. He had 3 weeks of training in Khartoum just to be able to distribute maybe 5-6 types of the tablets, dawa, as they say in Sudan, for the sicknesses like malaria, diabetes, maybe the snake bites somebody, he know what to do. But let me listen. This is my friend I met last week only, and only for one day and for one night. And on the end, I said, I'm going now to the Congress of the World Health. Please, what you would ask these people, what you would tell them, but be short, 1 minute and a half, nothing more. So that's what he said. This is Divan Yusuf Kua Maki from Nuba Mountains.
Yeah, rolling. All right. I am Divan Ibrahim Divan Kua, a medical in charge in Tese Abdusalam Hospital, Eastern Kadugli County. I am from Western Jebel. I am here to serve the life of people in Tese Abdusalam, Eastern Kadugli. We are really suffering here, and especially this community here. No medications in our clinic, no water, no food, no shelters to people who come from inside here. People are really suffering here. We really urge the whole humanitarian agencies, WHO, just of MSF, OCHA, if they can really help with medication for people, water and food, in order to serve the life of people here. Here, children are malnourished. Everywhere, people are dying of hunger, of treatment. Many cases are within these places here. For example, cases of STD in this community is so rampant, but we are just trying slowly to sort it down. Cases of leprosy are here, hypertension are here, diabetes are here, and many of them. So we urge all medical organizations to support these people, say that we should save their lives. Here, it is so dangerous for us to cross the border to Kadukli because the government of Sudan is just near us, not far away from us. Bombings are here throughout. Humanitarian forces are also circulating near us here. If we don't, we need your help, such that it should at least help our people here. We serve the land, and we need your interventions to bring peace, our people to get settled, to back to their life, and back to their land, and back to their homes. Because IDPs are here all over, there are many, and they are just scattered around here. They don't know where to go, and they don't know where to face to, and they don't have food for them. So we ask you kindly, if people can have that pity, to come and serve our life of our people here in Noble Mountain.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Today is the 21 of February 2024, and we are in the village of
Tez Abdus-Salam.
Tez Abdus-Salam, about 3 hour walking from Kadugli, South Kordofan, Sudan.
Yeah. Exactly.
Kadugli is the main government garnison. It's in among the mountains of the liberated area, as we call it, which is controlled by the Sudan People Liberation Army and movement, ruled by the Abdulaziz al-Hilu, president of probably new state. Probably Sudan will fall apart. Everyone will get some space on earth. Two forces are fighting among themselves. One is Sudan regular army, and another one is the militias that they call officially the rapid support forces. No politics, no judging. I want to show you the victims of this war, which started in April last year and produced up to now 10 million internally displaced people. This data is from the United Nations. And about 480,000 of the IDPs settled here in liberated areas that practically nobody even knows that is there, because media are not reporting. Doesn't matter what reason, Al Jazeera, BBC, CNN, Xinhua, or Russia Today are not reporting about the biggest refugee crisis on the planet this time. Why I am so passionately in this? Because I am visiting Sudan since 1979, when I came as a young hippie. I follow the Nile, and I like it, the space, a lot of space, and very charming people. At that time, Sudan was supposed to be a breadbasket for the Arab world, so everybody was excited. They believed that now, when we get rid of British, now we will have prosperity like all the rest of the world. But it didn't go this way. In 1979, the petrol was found, and then things changed completely. This is me, yes, at that time, 1979. I finished two faculties. I am graduated mechanical engineer and economist. And this was my last trip before I had to go to the army, the Yugoslav army, and then I should became more serious. I should start living like everybody else. I came with a donkey, that helped. And I had two goats, I bought two goats, and I had a bag of sorghum, sugar, salt, and with that little thing, I get the sympathy of the local Nuba in this mountain, who was at that time still very much naked. So I came naked as they was naked, and I think they respect that. Because in this garden of Eden, you know, at that time there was not much evil. Evil came just that year, 1998. So I ran home, and I come back when I got the book of Alex Deval, Nuba Facing Genocide. And in that book, a famous scholar, now it's in Harvard, he explained that Nuba are facing genocide. So I couldn't believe it. That was 1998. 20 years later, I took my bicycle and I went back this time with the bicycle, not with donkey because it goes too slow. I was that strong. I already came around the world with the three bicycles, and I believe it. With the bicycle, you can smuggle everywhere because no one see enemy on you. Some people think you are crazy. Others believe that you are seeking your own way to God, as they do in Sudan. But nobody really cared, you know, that you could be a spy or a reporter or something. That time I fell in love with Nuba, even first time. But that time I really fell in love with Nuba because they've been under siege. I reported that in the book. English translation would be Petrol and Water. Yes. Then the next time I come with the Boyana. This is my wife sitting here. She was the best. Not donkey, not bicycle, was so practical. As a photographer and as a lover, we married in 2013 in Nuba Mountains after reporting for a couple of years already on the genocide on Nuba going on. We published, we done it, books, and we produced documentary films, and some of them, they catch attention of the world, and the donations start coming, and because we didn't have nobody to do that instead of us, we started delivering to Nuba Mountains everything except this finger to shut down the aeroplane, or SAM-7, which has the same mission, to stop this Russian made Antonov and Chinese made jet bombing Nuba. Yeah, we used little small drone to document. That's how we became activists. Activist is maybe very bad word, but you know, when you see the leopard, when you met the leopard, like we done it 2017, you cannot get rid of it, you never forget. These people are thinking, they are rotting alive, and we photographed them, produced documentary film, Rotting 2022, and we took this picture to Dr. Tedros in Geneva on the head of the World Health Organization with the Slovenian support. The government was with us. The Minister for Health, Madame Selat, went with Dr. Vesna Petrić, who was at that time representing Slovenia in World Health Organization, and they introduced that all world can get medicine to eradicate the leprosy, but not the Nuba in South Kordofan. Why? And Dr. Tedros answered after a couple of months that there is too much danger there. It is too dangerous. I cannot send the doctors and crew there. because it's a war area, so nothing really starts moving. So we started on our own. We started taking lepers from the mountains, and we organized sort of leprosarium in the Catholic hospital of the local bishop. And Dr. Tom Catena from United States, as a practical doctor, he's now looking after lepers. But to get medicine directly, legally, up to now, we didn't succeed. Now it's 7 years since we started asking for the medicine. And we have been full of hope because Novartis is producing three types of antibiotics that can eradicate the leprosy in a year, maybe 2 years. And they said up till 2020, there will be no leprosy in the world. And mostly, yes, there is no leprosy anymore in the world, except here in Luma Mountain. Why do people have to suffer without medicine? There's a political problem, of course, but we will not talk about politics. I was warned that don't mention nobody, and I believe this is fair. Let's just focus on these people who are rotting alive. And on one fact, I believe they are rotting because of ethics. It's an ethical problem. It's not only a political problem. They are rotting because we in West, who produce this medicine and could deliver anywhere, are not sending to them. So the problem of leprosy in Sudan is the problem of the Western ethic. And here we get many warnings last year. The last I heard from famous Slovenian philosopher Slavoj Žižek, he said, Europe is dying. I have the same feeling. I believe that we should wake up and start to break this collective depression and apathy and start doing brave things as they've done it our heroes before. I don't want colonialism, I don't want imperialism, but I want that you crusaders, you know, human rights and doctors and the ones who give yes to hypocrites, don't change this with hypocrisy. You have to do it. It looks like hypocrisy, but it's not. Hypocrisy is something that cannot be tolerated anymore because we are very much on the edge of the Western civilization. If we will be still lying and pretending, we will go. We will finish. Nothing will remain. Just like nothing reminded of these people here in Luba Mountains. All of them, you are looking at them now, they are dead. What's happening to them will catch us. So this is time to pull the head out of the tent. I believe it's the last time. Maybe 5 years, 10 years. But okay, let's start somewhere. We organized concerts, all Slovenian musicians came. We in Kinošiška showed our documentary film on leprosy, rotting 2022, and we collected 30,000 euros. We can do it. The big organizations, especially agencies of UN and NGOs, they cannot do it. How? I will not judge. I am with them. I just come from them, and I would like to, instead of being angry, entertain you with a little bit. I want to introduce another hero, the heroes who first photographed this mountain. The first one was British George, officer George Roger. In 1949, he was so frustrated and traumatized by the World War II, where he filmed Baden-Belsen, Auschwitz, Dachau. By the way, my father was in Dachau. He survived 3 years. And he wrote a book, Never Give Up, Boy. So how can I end with no struggling? These are his photographs of the culture that George Roger believed is superior to European. They are not, they don't need to expand and colonize and kill and rape and steal. They're happy, you know, with nature, with love, with lawmaking. This is the paradise, the only paradise. You cannot reach any other paradise than if you fell in love with woman that you go with together. No, this is Ivan Kores, the son of famous Spanish photographer who came after George Roger in the 70s. He was 6 years old when his family decided to go as a hippie, you know, to Africa, to search for free love, which was promised in Africa, although it's not true at all. Only same cultures, maybe they do practice, but mainly not. So this year, in December, we invited Ivan Kores to go back and see what remains of the people his father and mother, Bebete and Antonio, photographed from 1974 to 1979. I couldn't believe it that these people who survived genocide recognized this man who is now a big man, he's 55. And I couldn't believe how happy they were to see him and how this is eastern part of the mountain, how he was accepted back and how they liked him. Charming people. Extremely charming people. This is not flirting, what the Nuba do. Nuba doesn't flirt. Flirt is connected with the sexuality, but charming is that you make everyone happy with the beauty of his support. Yes, the family of Kores was very different than Leni Riefenstahl, who was there in between. Leni Riefenstahl is the famous filmmaker. He produced documentaries that really affect Europe during the World War II with the Nazi propaganda. These are helping us now. A lot of blood. These people, they do have to express their manhood. So they have to go through training, and then they have to wrestle, and in this wrestling with the iron bracket, there is blood. But if you don't, that was in old time. These pictures are from 1979, 1783. If you don't express yourself, you will not dance. I mean, you will not be chosen by women. So two principles met here. Men must be brave and women must be erotically attractive, otherwise she will not be accepted. And they are the ones, the woman is the one that chooses the favorite, not the man or the family. That's the most natural way how things move in the universe. She chooses the favorite with the leg around the neck of the favorite, of the chosen one. This is only, I never met this or such a culture nowhere else, although I travel it everywhere, all continents, most of the states around the world. These are photos of George Roger. Two different opponents of the World War. And these are photos of Leni Riefenstahl. Very different photos. Very different photos. Each one was searching something here in Cauniaro, as in this eastern part of mountains, named. Each one was looking for something. This is Leni. This is her book. Leni was dancer, actor, film actor, and director. Everything. And this is the family of Ivan. Mama Bebete, father Antonio, and the son Ivan. And these are their pictures, very different than other two photographs. Little Ivan, he was going naked as the others, with no shoes, no school, and he loved it. When he came back to Spain, he didn't want to go back to school, it was too much. He said, I went only for one day, then I had enough. So he said, these people must never savages. Although they were naked, they were never primitive. They had very high culture. He wrestled with his mother, his friends. He painted himself. That was life in Cauniaro in 70s. Then changed. Everything changed. Everything changed. Of course, the photos of these three people has been seen in Khartoum, and there was a big reaction. Government decided that this picture cannot represent Sudan. Sudan is a serious Islamic state, and they went here. They come and they destroy this pagan culture. And what we found it this year and last year with Bojana, it are the results. What I found after Bojana and Ivan went home was drama. The same medical assistant you can see here in the middle, Ivan Divan Yusuf Kuamaki, took me to that couple of thousand of refugees, IDPs, who came from Khartoum, from Kadugli, from Talodi, and other garnisons of the government control. He took me to these people in the western part of Nuba Mountains, very near Kadugli. And she said, this woman, they all came from government side. They are soldiers, Nuba soldiers. There's no white people or red people, no Arabs, no Turks there. They are only Nuba, and they send the families here to our liberated area, because only here there is no war. All around Sudan, the rapid support forces and the regular army are fighting. Only here is safe. And they, the men, they stay there in the garnison because they have no chance to run away. They are indoctrinated, they are soldiers, and they follow the strategy, kill the slave with the slave. And they might die soon. They might die very soon because liberated area is controlled by Abdelaziz El Hilu. He is enough smart and well man, sophisticated man, that he didn't attack yet this garnison. He could do it because his traditional enemy is killing each other in the north, in the south, west, and east. He could do it, but he said to us, too many innocent people will die. Innocent people are the indoctrinated people, because what they can do, I mean, they cannot go out of this cave in the head, among the bones of school. They cannot go out. So they will probably die. You will probably not hear this from the media, because as I said, there is conspiracy against Sudan for a long time, for a long time. No news, no news. News are no good. News are very bad. So let they kill each other, then we might get petrol and uranium. It's all wars in this. Ukraine and Gaza, every day, this biggest humanitarian problem, not mentioned many times. UN said 10 million IDPs. That's much more than in all these war conflicts around the world today together. More people died here in Sudan in the last 30 years than in Afghanistan, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Libya, together. But no news. And that's why you probably doesn't know this. My mission is to call you human rights activists, you crusaders, you men with glory, you know, who want to do something good, go to this woman and help them. I went home because I promised to come for the Congress. But you know, this lady who thinks here, they somehow touched my heart more than the woman in Europe who smell nice. They came with the children. They are not guilty of nothing. They not understand the politics. Also in Sudan, it's not allowed to talk about politics. Politics is always something very, very dirty. Look them. Not many men. Most of the men were already killed. Some of these men are the local Nuba who accepted them. As the medical assistant said in the beginning, there is no water. That's why they stink. Water is not enough even for drinking, because now 400,000 on 500,000 Luba who live here, and now this 480,000, that's once more people, and resources of water in the dry season are already very low, very low. And they had that rain last year. And the locusts come, and locusts eat the greens, so they cannot eat leaves. This is the main problem, that in these Numa Mountains now, people, hungry people, cannot eat leaves of Tabaldi, Lilop, Ardet, and other trees. There is no grass. Grass is, you cannot wipe your bottom. You cannot use grass to wipe your bottom. This is a big problem. No water. Slowly, slowly you adapt, and you notice that you don't need to wipe your bottom. Donkey doesn't wipe, bicycle doesn't wipe. My wife Boyana do, but you know, pigs and cows, you can survive, but you need water. Because if you don't drink water one day, at evening, you will be dead. In this 40, 45, up to 52 degrees heat of March, and April will be worse. And May, there will be first drops of rain. That means another 2 months. How many thousands, 10,000 of people will die? Because we have no news, and we don't know that this is happening in the Sudan, in the most demonized state in the world. When I was first time there in 79, when I come with the donkey, I'm naked, you know, there was a feeling that this is the most prosperous African country. Now it's the worst on the planet. There are two Sudans now, one is the south and one is the north. The foreigners divided this country, and they control both of it. And they don't want this country. Why? There is not only racism. It's even worse. It's something that is spreading out of Africa, and it's coming to Europe. We have now war here, and in the Middle East war also. Who, is there any could we see in the concept this war? Can we see that this is not just war for these people, it's also for us? That we are, you might finish like them soon. We have to look big picture. The whole planet, I'm trying to see the whole planet, and I can see these things are, these words are connected. Epic is finished. In Darfur, biggest war in Sudan, the children are killing the children, and they are sending death on internet. You can find them. I don't want to show you that. I want to finish with something positive, with something beautiful, really, something hope. At least a little hope must be. If we lost that little hope, then we will all start killing each other. Doesn't matter how much technology we have and how sweet we can eat and how comfortable we can sleep. We will go into history. Yes, I have hope because I met this woman. They are not whinging. They are not crying. They have inside them this force, the woman force. We have to give birth. We have to make love. We are here to give love to our men, to husbands. We are born for love. No? And that's what really catches so much my heart. And with this idea that we are here to make love, I wish to finish this my presentation. When you go to the cave now in Kostojna, that's where my wife is there, from there, don't forget that what you see in the cave is not reality. Reality is outside of the bones of our skin. Platon said that. He said only the one who can really see, the sun and the trees and grass and animals and other people outside of the cave, he sees reality. Thank you for your attention.